Experimentation is at the heart of all scientific endeavors and understanding. It has led to breakthroughs in better understanding the world and even ourselves. Speaking of ourselves, we, along with our animal friends, have been experimented on, and sometimes for nefarious purposes. So today, I'm discussing a few unethical experiments in the psychological sciences and even the neurosciences. But before I do, make sure to subscribe to this channel if you want more bite-sized videos to feed your brain. That being said, here are those experiments which demonstrate that human depravity knows no bounds. Number 5, Pig Brain Revival Experiment. In 2019, an article in Nature was published detailing how researchers revived cellular functions of pig brains 4 hours after they had been slaughtered. The system that they used, they termed Brain X, and was designed to cool down the brain, remove the blood, and then return some level of functioning back to the brain. Now, the brains were separated from the pigs, so the system is only applicable to disembodied brains. Once the process becomes more sophisticated and advanced, this may be a promising avenue in reviving brain dead patients. But there are some ethical questions remaining. The primary being is if any of these pigs obtained any level of consciousness, thus creating undue suffering in these animals. While the researchers state that the brains did not demonstrate the complex neural activity that is indicative of consciousness, this actually cannot be stated definitively, as researchers are still arguing on what consciousness actually is and how it's represented in the brain. In fact, during a question and answer session, researchers noted that they actually couldn't say for certain that the brains did not obtain consciousness. Time is usually what allows us to better discern what is ethical and unethical. In this case, only time will tell if this experiment was ethical and a benefit to humankind. Number 4, Facebook Feelings Manipulation Study. One commonality you'll see among the studies on this list is the lack of obtaining written consent from participants. To diminish potential physical and psychological harm to research participants, norms were established in order to assure that all participants were informed of the study and of their rights to, at any point, decline to participate in the study. These standards apply under the U.S. Department of Health and even academic institutions. Unfortunately, private corporations are not expected to consider the rights and welfare of research subjects, as was the case when Facebook conducted a study designed to manipulate the emotional states of unsuspecting participants. In this study, Facebook behavioral researchers manipulated the newsfeed of unwitting users in order to evoke positive emotions, such as happiness, or negative emotions, such as feelings of depression. They found that they not only were able to manipulate these feelings in social media users, but also that these feelings would last for days. While there was no reporting of lasting harm, when the study was made known to the unsuspecting public, outrage ensued, and for good reason. You see, because researchers did not notify their participants of the study and the study's intentions, since of course they were not informed of their participation, the emotional states lasted longer than they actually should have, and this could have some serious consequences for these subjects. Further, the researchers and Facebook argued that consent is provided when one agrees to the terms and conditions to use the social media platform, but there is some major issues here. First, it does not conform with the minimum standards of ethics established by the U.S. Department of Health, as subjects give written consent to participate when they are provided information about the study. This written consent is obtained to demonstrate that research participants are well informed of the benefits and risks of their participation in any given study. In line with this is the fact that once participants were experiencing harm, such as the intentionally manipulated depressing mood states, the subjects were not able to quit the study. Forced participation in research studies should never be the norm. But since these kinds of studies are conducted by private corporations, outside of public outcry, there's very little that can be done. Number 3, torture programs and research. Following World War II, the US hired many former Nazi scientists. So in the mid-20th century, CIA scientists involved in the development of psychological programs were former Nazi scientists. In the early 1960s, programs which focused on drugs, such as LSD, were found to be less reliable and minimally effective. So, the CIA did what any other organization would do that had no care for human rights and ethics, and looked to other forms of psychological manipulation, and experiments regarding psychological torture were implemented. These experiments began under the MK-Ultra program by Donald Hebb, who was the chair of psychology at McGill University. Subjects, who were students at the time, underwent sensory deprivation and would experience a complete mental breakdown in a couple of days, a state that researchers argued was only temporary. However, the CIA desired irreversible damage. Luckily, a CIA medical officer put a stop to that project, declaring it to be immoral and inhuman. The CIA went on to find other researchers, and with their help, created the official book on interrogation, the Kubrick Counterintelligence Manual. The manual was nothing short of a series of torture techniques designed to extract confessions, false or otherwise. Comprised of information learned from human research by over 200 researchers over a 15-year time span, it includes sensory deprivation and self-inflicted pain as reliable forms of enhanced interrogation. It should be noted that such interrogation techniques are under the premise that coerced confessions are reliable, something that has been well established to not be the case. So much so that any confessions provided under coercion are actually inadmissible in court. Further, in 2006, former military interrogators wrote a letter to Congress stating that such psychological and physical torture does not result in reliable confessions. Unfortunately, many people in power and the general citizenry still believe that confessions provided under conditions of torture are reliable, an idea that has consistently been shown to be completely false. Number 2, UCLA Schizophrenia Medication Experiment. In 1983, the researchers at the University of California, Los Angeles, started studying patients with schizophrenia, but there was a catch. These patients, who went to the university for routine treatment, were taken off of their medications so that the scientists could observe the effects of patients no longer on antipsychotics. Often, people with schizophrenia take antipsychotic medications in order to prevent relapses. Without the medications, common symptoms of the illness are paranoia and hallucinations. Many of the patients experienced severe relapses, to the point of where one student with schizophrenia dropped out of school and began threatening the lives of their parents. Sadly, another student died by suicide due to the severe relapse that was experienced when the medications were stopped by these researchers. Despite all of these things, the study still continued until Congress had to intervene after receiving complaints from the families of these patients. One researcher unaffiliated with the university stated that the informed consent process is actually outdated, making it easy for experiments such as this one to take place without the subjects understanding the full risks of study participation. The researchers had no safeguards in place when and if patients relapse into severe psychosis. In fact, one patient reported having gone through a severe state of psychosis for months without any help from the researchers. Number 1, the Tuskegee Syphilis Study. The Tuskegee Syphilis Study often lands on or near the top of similar lists due to the sheer unethical nature of the scientists' behaviors. In 1932, researchers in the Public Health Service working with the Tuskegee Institute recruited about 600 African American males to participate in a large-scale study to understand what they termed bad blood, which could have been anything from fatigue to syphilis, but in this case, they were studying syphilis. The problem was that the researchers were not recruiting these participants to test new medications, but rather to withhold existing treatment from them and observe the effects of the disease over time, despite long-term progression of the illness being well understood by the medical community. It wasn't until 1972 when the Associated Press released a story about these experiments that researchers were forced to terminate the study. That means that researchers continued the Tuskegee syphilis experiment for 40 years, pretending to treat African-American participants for illnesses while secretly observing their symptoms. And the illness was curable. Due to public outcry, the study was almost halted immediately. However, by that time, it was too late, and many participants had died or experienced incurable symptoms, and even went on to infect other members of their own community. The remaining survivors, after several years in deliberations, received about $10 million. This study is one of the most cited studies on the dangers of unethical medical research. It had a huge influence on the creation of the Internal Review Board, or IRB. The IRB supervises and attempts to ensure that human-focused research remains ethical. So what does this mean for science today? Well, what I do know is that the motivations of these scientists aren't really important, but their actions have left scars, not only on the lives they inflicted their studies upon, but also on the psychological sciences and other human-based sciences. This is why ethical considerations must always be taken into account when undergoing any research project. Scientific discovery relies on trust, and all of these instances of scientific malpractice has helped corrode the trust between the scientific community and the general public. Ethic watchdog groups, in collaboration with scientists, continue to work on rebuilding this broken relationship by having checks at every level, checks that need to be added to the private sector. Only then will people see the many, many scientists who truly strive to do no harm. If you found this video informative, consider subscribing to my channel and sharing with family and friends. Also, make sure to hit that like button. Also, if you want to support my channel, please consider heading over to my Patreon page to become a contributing member. And as always, thank you for watching.